Hi, everyone. I'm going to tell you about the Lattice semester that's going to happen in the spring. Some of these slides I used actually last year, but there's some new ones. And I'm organizing this with Daniele Micciancio from UCSD, with Vinod Vaikundaran from MIT, and Hotek Wee, who's in Paris normally, but now he's also in Algorand in Boston. Lattices. So this is a picture of a lattice. So this is a bunch of coins, right? And there's a grid. And we define this lattice essentially according to a basis. So these are two basis vectors, and you can express all these green points as some integer combinations of the basis vectors. So for example, this b1 plus b2 and so forth, b1 minus b2. Although this is two-dimensional, in general, we're going to be interested in n-dimensional lattices. And again, it's all integer combinations, so it's integer lattices of the n basis vectors. Turns out that for this same lattice, you could have different basises. We have a notion of a short basis, a long basis, a better basis, a worse basis. So here's a different basis. And you could express the points as combinations of this basis. So in fact, there are infinitely many basis that are possible. And there are some computational problems that we can define with respect to this structure and have been defined for, it doesn't come really from our neck of the woods, but this is a well-known mathematical problems. So for example, one problem is the shortest vector problem. So given a basis, so given these vectors, b1, b2, or up to bn, find the shortest non-zero vector. So a combination of them that will give us the shortest vector. It turns out that this problem will vary in difficulty depending on what basis we're given. So some basis are going to allow to find such a short vector much more efficiently than others. So a first step, in some sense, you could think of for solving this problem is to find such better basis. Another problem is called the closest vector problem, and that is, again, we are given a basis to specify the lattice. And the kind of question we're asking now is not the shortest vector that is in the lattice, is a combination, integer combination of these basis vectors, but given a point that's not one of the green points, find the closest point which is green to it. So that's the closest vector problem. So for example, this guy is not in the lattice, and we would like to know, let's say, the green one is close to it. That's another one of these hard problems. What do I mean by hard? I mean that we don't have polynomial time algorithms for it. In fact, we don't even have good polynomial time algorithms to approximate the answer. So we have the notion of alpha approximation for shortest vector. Again, given the basis, fine, an alpha approximate shortest non-zero, so the difference, you know, is an alpha factor away. We can do the same for the closest vector. Okay, so this is a problem that's extremely important for computer science to solve well. So the best example of what this would give us is integer programming. So integer programming, you know, this is something that's very familiar. We get a bunch of equations. We want to have a solution. We want an integer solution. So whereas if this, we didn't insist on integer solutions, we can do this. Simplex might not be polynomial time worst case, but we have polynomial time algorithms. Integer solutions, that's NP hard. And however, we can also think of this as a lattice problem. So can sort of think of a lattice and find a solution would be a point in this lattice inside of this convex body. In turn, that means that if we're given a basis for this lattice, we can think of it as finding a short or close vector in the corresponding lattice. And again, if we had a good basis, this become an easier problem. So there's a lot of pictures here just to give you an idea that this structure, this mathematical structure, has direct correlation to solving some of the most basic problems that we can think about in optimization. And indeed, this is probably one of the most famous algorithms, if not the most famous algorithm, when I was a graduate student, or maybe I was assistant professor already. So Lenstra-Lenstra-Lobos algorithm, the L cube, finds the shortest vector in constant dimensions in polynomial time, and 2 to the n over 2 approximation in n dimensions. So this is a polynomial time. That's the good news. It's only an approximation, a pretty bad one, unless you restrict the dimensions. Okay. So what we want to do in this semester is, the corollary is the integer programming is in constant number of variables is solvable in polynomial time. That's very important. Anyway, the best algorithm for when we don't restrict, but we allow n to grow, For alpha approximation, runs in this time. So alpha is over here. That will give me an alpha factor of approximation, but the running time is exponential. So all this is not great news in terms of running time, but it is sort of interesting that it's even true for quantum algorithms. Whereas, you know, a lot of famous problems in number theory, you know, factoring, discrete log, and so forth, elliptic curve log, can be done very quickly on a quantum computer. We have no idea how to beat this, really, on a quantum computer. And all this is good for cryptography. So essentially, we're looking for hard problems. And it used to be that the factoring, discrete log, elliptic log were the hard problems on which all electronic commerce is based on. I think Ormila also will talk about this in a minute when she talks about her program, which is going to run at the same time. But in any case, we want to have something that's easy. On one hand, when you are the legal user in the system, let's say you're the sender and the receiver, but it's hard for an adversary trying to break a crypto system. A crypto system might be encryption, might be digital signatures, might be cryptographic protocols. We're not restricting to one thing in particular. And lattices, obviously, since there's a hard problem, we would like to have a structure there where there's something that's easy and something that's hard. And in fact, that is the case. Again, just to iterate, the reason why this is great for cryptography is because the best algorithms are exponentially hard. It is quantum resistant. There is this incredible theorem or field that talks about that it's not just hard on the average, but it's hard in the worst case. In fact, this whole attention to lattice-based cryptography was by a theorem by Itai, totally motivated by theoretical basic research type of interest. Finding a problem which seems to be hard in the worst case, and you showed a reduction between worst case and average. And for cryptography, that's really what you want, because we're going to use sort of average instances in real life, and we want to have some evidence that those average case instances are hard, and the evidence is the reduction between that and the worst case. And the interesting thing is that not only that we have a problem here that's hard, but it really, and that we are able to kind of identify some easy counterpart to the hard part, but it actually has much more ability, much more structure in it. It enables a lot of surprising capabilities, which we don't even know how to do for cryptography based on number theory. So the first public key, actually, just this picture here of Itai, who did the worst case to average, and the first crypto system that's really based on lattices was by Itai and Dwork, a public key crypto system. So there was number theory based like RSA, then there was based on lattices, and then it turned out that not only that you can do encryption, but you could do homomorphic encryption with lattices. Homomorphic encryption, people probably heard about this term. The idea is a super duper kind of encryption where not only that you can encrypt in a public key setting, so I can encrypt to Luca and he can decrypt, and I've never met him before, but he published a public key, but furthermore, so this is classical encryption, right? But now we want to actually, let's say, have like a genomic database. That's just an application. There's lots of encrypted genetic data by many different people. And you would like to do a GWAS, let's say a genomic-wide association study, but without decrypting first. Can you do it? So can you compute on encrypted data without decrypting? And with homomorphic encryption allows you to do such computation. So let's say in the GWAS example, you could do GWAS analysis on encrypted genomic sequences with encryption based on lattices. We don't know how to do this based on number theory. And it's a sort of secure collaboration. What do I want to say? So this is all beautiful. People have known this since 2008 because there's this system that Gentry, when he was a graduate student at Stanford, came up with homomorphic encryption based on some lattice problems. It progressed tremendously since 2008. So when Gentry came out with it, it wasn't exactly the lattice problem. It was some variant of it, only over ideal lattices. Now we know that we can actually use like a approximation of shortest vector problem as a basis for the homomorphic encryption schemes that exist today. That's one. And two, it was sort of hailed as the most infeasible theoretical result out there. That's never, nobody's ever going to be able to use it and so forth. And, you know, I hate to hear these kind of statements because it's never right, you know. It's just a question of effort and time in my experience. And indeed, for example, sorry, so you just so clear from what I said. You send all your encryption over, somebody computes, sends you back the result. So in fact, these days there is this competition, for example, that happens in UC San Diego. It's called the IDASH competition. Every year they have a different challenge on genomic data, of how to use cryptographic machinery to analyze genomic data. And the last one was to actually use homomorphic encryption. So in the past, it was to use multi-party protocols. But little by little, they're getting to the hard challenge, which is using homomorphic encryption. So something you couldn't think of doing in 2008, this year, you know, they had like 300 patients' data, 10,000 SNPs, whatever this means from genomic data, and the question is to do an analysis. That's it, I'm out of time. Well, okay, I will take another minute. and in fact, the running times are amazing. I mean, you could do things like, you know, these are second. Okay, so I just want to say, in my 1 minute that I stole from the program, that it's not just a homomorphic encryption, but for example, this morning, I think it was Jerry Lee that talked about this result from Microsoft, about that under RSA, there's some difficulty, or actually not difficulty, of robust classification. So there's a new result by Vinod and Akshay that they show assuming the hardness of learning parity with noise, which is related to this lattice stuff, but not exactly lattice, but related to it, they show that there's a classification task which these three things could exist. There is easily learned efficient classifiers, there's a small robust classifier, and it's computationally hard to learn any robust classifier. And if you can construct such a task, then you can build cryptography. I don't have time to get into it, but what I'm saying is understanding these problems well actually is also relevant to other issues than just computing on encrypted data. It's sort of an interesting thing that could be related to robust classification. And you can interpret this in many ways. One possibility is learning parity with noise is actually not hard. I mean, you don't, because maybe it's impossible to find a task for which these three properties are true. And just one other thing is also related to delegation. So, you know, proving, let's say computation is done in the cloud and the cloud wants to prove to you that it was done correctly and it wants to prove it with succinct proofs, then also under learning with errors, there are these very efficient proofs. For all deterministic polynomial time computation. So learning with errors seems, which is related to lattice crypto, is extremely useful bunch of piece of mathematics to learn. And that's it. So I was going to write down all about NIST, that they've started planning for post-quantum cryptography. And that is intimately tied with understanding lattice-based cryptography. And there's lots of goals for the semester. One of them is going to be interact with, I think, the quantum program, which Armilla, I think, is next. And I think the time is really right for this, because we can do amazing things, but we have to make absolutely sure that we've explored how robust this is for quantum algorithms and for algorithms in general. And it would be good also to work with mathematicians to understand the what kind of lattices have structure in them and are still, in some sense, safe. Because the more structure we have, the more efficient these systems are, but then you're not using a general assumption. Lots and lots of great problems. So I know that you're getting very impatient, and therefore I shall stop. Thank you.